Data models have a profound effect not only on how we think about the problems we are solving, but also how we write code. That's a quote from Martin Kleppmann, a professor at Cambridge University. And that's what this talk is about, as Cecile said, data models. Welcome to 10 tips using SqlDBM data modeling tool on the Snowflake Data Cloud. My name is Dan Galavan. I am an independent data architecture consultant. I've been advising clients and leading the delivery of data solutions for 25 years. That's leading national initiatives in Ireland, working on pan-European initiatives, working with clients in the Middle East and North America. I'm also a Snowflake Data Cloud consultant, trainer. Okay, what is data modeling? Well, to model data is to provide a usually graphical representation of the data in our domain. What is the data we are trying to work with? What is the data we're trying to identify? How should it look? What are our expectations? What are our definitions? Okay, so it has a very important governance role. We use data models to figure out how we're going to store and manage our data. We use data modeling for data quality purposes. Data security, what data do we need to secure? So it's like a compass or a guide in terms of data solution rollout. Ooh, data modeling is key for data integration. So when we're bringing different data sets together, like your old school data warehousing, or even with data mesh, like data products, it's not unusual for them to be integrated. Scope definition is another one. For example, a high-level model, you know, what parts of our data domain do we need to focus on to deliver our data solution? So a data model is actually a communication tool. Irrespective of the role and the type of data model, it acts as a communications tool, like signposts. And we also use data modeling for automation, for generating, for example, SQL. So it's all about getting to trustworthy data. So tip number one of our 10 tips using SqlDBM data modeling tool on the Snowflake Data Cloud. Before we go near any tech, we have to figure out what kind of data model do we need, right? And how do we figure that out? It's all about the audience. If it's a technical audience, I mean, if I say data modeling to you, is it likely you're probably going to think about this model on my left, your right? And that's a physical data model. That's for a technical audience. That's the kind of model we actually put into a database like Snowflake. There are lots of other types of models, and on your left are two examples, like conceptual, logical. They're more abstract, less technical, for a less technical audience. So it depends on what our goal is in terms of what we want to achieve and how we want to use our data models. And I'll give you an example very quickly. Conceptual models. Right, it's all about what are our core concepts, like customer, like product, like transaction. What are the definitions? What are the business rules? What are the associations between them? Because that, first of all, sets down our cornerstones in terms of our design, but also feeds into how we can define data quality. What does right look like? And in the middle, we have our logical model, which is not quite technical, but it's more detailed. And really, with any of this type of modeling, a key phrase is requirements-driven, okay? We don't need to model everything. It's what are the requirements asking us to do. So, hands up, any Snowflake users here? Okay, brilliant. So, what is the Snowflake Data Cloud? It's, at its core, is an analytical platform, but it's got tons of use cases. Data warehousing, data lake, data mesh, data science, data engineering, data sharing, and more recently, apps. And when we talk about data modeling on the Snowflake Data Cloud, that actually goes hand in hand with SqlDBM. So what is SqlDBM? It's an online data modeling tool. It's a SaaS data modeling tool. Great for governance, great for data model accessibility, great. It actually can configure like lots of different target models, not just Snowflake. So now we've identified the core tech. I mean, there's other tech around this. There's obviously DevOps components and so on, which we will touch on. But tip number three, table design. And by the way, we've gone now into this model here on your right. Okay, we're looking now at a physical model. And how can we design that for Snowflake, right? So a couple of tips. Some very straightforward. We need to get our data type configuration right, okay? So you'll see here, on the about five columns down, we have postal code, right? That's got a very forgiving varchar 9. But what we're saying is, like, that should, with spaces, that should probably be max 8 characters. But what we're saying is, look, these are the rules. Anything outside of this deviates from what we expect in terms of data quality in this context. Things like saying our fields are non-nullable. And address line 1 is a classic example of more often than not, it's required. Near the bottom, you see there's a purple piece of text. That's called a variant data type. That's what Snowflake uses to store semi-structured data. Like JSON, like XML, like Avro, okay? And what that means is we can just put that type of data into our model and figure out later on what we want to do with it. Like, and that leads to schema on read. So we don't define our schema until we're actually taking a look at that data. Two other very quick tips. You see here, near the bottom right, there's a number 7. What we're doing there is configuring Snowflake data retention, which literally means how many days worth of history of data versions do we want to keep? Okay, and that ties in with Snowflake time travel. And one other tip, right now, Snowflake are rolling out their own copilot to generate SQL and so on. So a best practice is when we are configuring our databases, try to use more business-friendly names. Again, taking address line 1 as an example. So I could have called that AD_LN_1. But if we spell out the names, we get better return on our Snowflake Copilot outputs, like SQL statements that it generates. Tip number 4. Over the years, I have identified 11 data modeling principles. That's number 2. Business definitions are the gold dust of data modeling. And I'll give you an example. I was working with an enterprise financial services client. And depending on which team I spoke to, they talked about arrangements, agreements. Another team spoke about facilities. And another team spoke about trades. But by working with the subject matter experts and the business analysts, I got the definitions of each of those terms. And it turns out they were all, at a high level, the same thing. They were all actually agreements between two or more counterparties. And that had a really strong influence on the data model that I was designing. So what does that mean in brass tacks, in actual data modeling terminology? We can take our definitions and actually put them onto our data model. And this, I always see this. It's always neglected, but it's very, very effective and powerful. So you see here, the blue column that's highlighted, we're putting, using SqlDBM, we're putting on a definition for that column. And then we're using some automation to generate SQL. And that's actually an alter statement, so we're making a change to our database. We take that a step further, and you see the comment keyword that's highlighted in purple? Snowflake will take that and apply that to its data dictionaries. And if you're familiar with databases, when I say data dictionaries, I mean the information underscore schema views. Okay, and we also get data dictionaries from SqlDBM. We can generate Excel documents, very consumable by not so technical audiences. This is very effective for data literacy, very effective for, you know, that colleague who knows the system really well, but it's all up here. It's all tacit knowledge. And then it's fine until they go on vacation or they get a promotion or they change roles, okay? This is a very effective way to address the risk around tacit knowledge. Tip number five, data classification. Literally labeling our data, right? See on the top left, I put in a tag in SqlDBM called personal data. It's just a label. We take it a step further, and we can apply that tag in our data models. So you're going to see three fields there with small little blue labels on the right-hand side. We use our automation. We forward engineer. We generate our tags in Snowflake. Once those tags are in Snowflake, we can apply those tags to row-level security, column-level security. And basically, that will determine. You see on the screenshot, the stars, that's column masking, which is influenced by tagging, OK? So that's data classification. Tip number six is view lineage. This is actually what's called column lineage. There's other types of lineage as well, but it's the visual flow of data. And on your right, we have the target view. And as we work back, we get, where did that view come from? I wish I had this 15 years ago. I was brought in to work, resolve an issue for a client with their billing, because they were billing clients who had already been billed. They were not billing clients who had not been billed. The business rules were implemented incorrectly. And once I started analyzing the issue, it turned out that the billing logic was built on a very complex hierarchy of database views. Yes, I figured it out. Yes, I worked through it. But being able to use view lineage would have been a much faster way to address the issue, okay? We can create our views in our data modeling tool, or we can reverse engineer, as in get the definition from our database and bring that view back into our data modeling tool. Tip number seven, version control. Just because it's data modeling does not mean we should not version. And this is all part of governance, by the way. And there are different types of version control options we have. But the option I'm going to focus on with SqlDBM is called concurrent modeling. Okay, so within the tool, we can actually branch our models, configure permissions on each of those branches, and merge back to main, all within the tool. And that type of branching captures all of the configuration within our data model. So not just the SQL aspects and the table design and so on, but also the positioning of our objects on our model canvas and things like that. So that's concurrent modeling. Tip number eight, forward engineering. Again, just because it's data modeling does not mean it shouldn't be plugging in to our DevOps pipelines. And it actually has to. Data modeling has to be agile, okay? And one of the ways we do agile with modeling actually is we'd be very requirements focused and actually trying to stay ahead of the sprint ahead. And that's tricky, but it can be done, right? However, either way, our data modeling outputs have to plug in to our DevOps pipelines to be part of the solution. It all has to go together, as you may be aware. So what do? We forward engineer our database design. So you remember the physical model back on slide number three on your right. We use that to generate SQL. And we can generate different kinds of SQL. SQL to create a database, SQL to change a database, because our data modeling tool, we can actually compare versions of our model, and it will figure out the delta, and it will figure out what kind of SQL do we need to change our model in Snowflake. So we forward engineer. We can apply the SQL directly in Snowflake, or we can push to a DevOps pipeline, like Azure DevOps, like AWS Code Commit, like GitHub. Again, all part of data modeling governance. And it's not limited to data model governance, but it's very important with data model delivery that we have this component. What's a number one fundamental for DevOps? Reproducibility, okay? If we run the same pipeline, we should get the same results, including recreating environments, for example. What's database drift or schema drift? That's when we have unmanaged changes within our DevOps pipeline, okay? And unmanaged changes can have unintended consequences. It can have an effect on the quality of our data model and our overall data solution. So we can switch on using SqlDBM, actually, switch on Snowflake data modeling or data monitoring, right? So what does that do? It takes a baseline of our current Snowflake environment, whether it's dev, UAT, SIT, whatever it is. And the next time that that monitoring runs, it will actually look for changes and send notifications. Now, if it's expected changes, that's fine. But the changes we want to pick up on are actually the unexpected ones, and then we can address them. And what you see in the screenshot, actually, is that they on the left are two monitoring runs. We've done a comparison, and we can see that a view has changed, and a tag actually has dropped. And it's a question of, is that expected? And if it's not, then we need to troubleshoot. So that's schema monitoring to look for schema drift or database drift. Tip number 10, data modeling and AI. We all know the old adage, garbage in, garbage out. And AI is no exception. AI is often a consumer of data models. So it's very important that our data models and the data in our data models more specifically are trustworthy. So if we follow the nine other tips that I've given you, right, around model governance, version control, looking for unexpected changes proactively, data classification, which can be often driven by legislation like GDPR, data privacy, and so on, using our data model to inform us what data we should secure, what geographical location our model our data should be in, because labels will help us with that. All of these things feed into the mix for data governance, a good quality set of data in our data model, which our data model can enforce or be used to guide. And if that happens, the sun should shine on your data and AI solutions. So thank you very much. Do keep in touch on LinkedIn. By the way, the SqlDBM booth is actually out there on the left. They love talking about data modeling. And if you have any questions, let me know. Thank you very much.